first I want to lay out that you and I should not be surprised that many of the traditions of men are in fact doctrines of demons. Why? Well, because the Apostle Paul warned us. Notice in 1 Timothy 4:1, Paul said, "But the Spirit explicitly says that in later times some will fall away from the faith, paying attention to deceitful spirits and doctrines of demons." Now, you know what the doctrines of demons means in the Greek? It means doctrines of demons. Okay, this is real. Now, turn your Bibles ahead to 1 Timothy 4:3. Aren't you glad you have me here to point these things out? 1 Timothy 4:3, please turn your Bibles two verses ahead. I want you to see what things are consistent with doctrines of demons. You'll see that they also are synonymous with the traditions of men. 1 Timothy 4:3. Notice here Paul talks about men who forbid marriage, doctrine of demons, and advocate abstaining from foods, doctrine of demons, which God has created to be gratefully shared in by those who believe and know the truth. Now, let's ask ourselves a logical question. Where in Scripture are we commanded not to marry? Are we commanded not to marry by the Lord? No. So the traditions of some men, these false teachers who were saying, "Thou shalt not marry," that's a doctrine of demons. Why? Because by not marrying, they're claiming you can be closer to God. Well, how can you be close to God and you can't get any closer? By being in Christ. So do you notice they're making a promise that doesn't make any sense? You can actually be close to God if you don't marry. Or notice abstaining from food. If you really want to be with God in a close relationship, stop eating peanut butter or stop eating pork or stop eating whatever it is. Dear ones, that's a compromise of the sufficiency of Christ. If you serve a Christ who can't make you close to God, then you have a different Christ and you're an idolater. And so all of these things show us that indeed many traditions of men have as their root being the doctrine of demons. Brothers and sisters, any doctrine that steers you away, any tradition that steers you away from the promises and the true prohibitions that are in Scripture is an attempt to steal the authority of Scripture from your lives, to make you in bondage and under the authority and lordship of the demons rather than Jesus Christ. That's how serious it is. Okay, now, what arenas or where do we find these types of battles? Well, I'm going to hit three of them in the applications. Number one, we see this in false religions and cults. False religions and cults are teaching the traditions of men, but ultimately they're the doctrines of demons. And the one I'm going to focus on today is Catholicism. Not because other false religions don't do the same thing, but because Catholicism in particular elevates the traditions of men as being on par with Scripture, and I'll show you how they do that. But let's begin with number one. We're going to look at how false religions often use the doctrines of and the traditions of men, which are really the doctrines of demons. The one that really stands out to me is Catholicism. Why? Because Catholicism rises and falls on tradition. In fact, the tradition that is most important to the Roman Catholic faith is the claim that the Pope has the authority of an apostle. That's the major claim that they make. But realize, when we talk about Roman Catholicism and how they elevate the Pope to being an apostle, it's not just limited to the Pope. It's also given to the College of Bishops. You see, when the College of Bishops gather together and they make a collective statement, that is as authoritative as an apostle as well. Okay? So the Pope, when he speaks ex cathedra, meaning from the seat, they think of it as the seat of Moses, he is speaking authoritatively as an apostle. Or when the collective decision of the bishops comes down, they claim that's as authoritative as the apostles. And so the Roman Catholic Church says this very thing in paragraph 77 of their Catechism. Listen to what it says. It says, "The apostles left bishops as their successors. They gave them their own position of teaching authority." So, dear ones, they believe that the bishops have the teaching authority when they all make a decision. But listen, they also believe that the Pope can speak as an apostle. They say, quote, "The Roman pontiff, head of the College of Bishops, enjoys this infallibility in virtue of his office. When, as supreme pastor and teacher of all the faithful, he proclaims in an absolute decision a doctrine pertaining to faith and morals, unquote. That's Second Vatican. So here's what you have to realize. Both the College of Bishops, when they speak, and when the Pope speaks ex cathedra, it's infallible. They claim it's from God. That's what they're claiming. In fact, notice here on the screen, paragraph 78 of their catechism, they say that this living transmission, whether it's from the Pope or the bishops, accomplished through the Holy Spirit, is called tradition. Now, why do they dare not call it Scripture? Well, because Scripture's already been written. But notice what they're going to do is they're going to elevate this tradition on the same level as Scripture. It's just that tradition is being written. That's their, what they would distinguish. But tradition has the same authority of Scripture. Not so says Eric Douma, so says the Roman Catholic Church. This is from their catechism, paragraph 82. They say, both Scripture and tradition must be accepted and honored with equal devotion. Again, for them, Scripture has been written. Tradition is like Scripture being written because it comes from their apostles. Now, dear ones, do you think because they have modern-day apostles, which is wrong, and I'll show you, that their doctrines are going to be consistent or in error? Well, they're going to be in error. Let me show you some examples where. One example I can give are about beliefs regarding Mary. The Roman Catholic Church, because they have modern-day apostles who are proclaiming tradition as Scripture, they claim that Mary does all sorts of things that the Scriptures do not. For example, they claim that Mary had an immaculate conception. Not that Jesus was born in a perfect sinless way, which is true, but that she herself was without sin. Now, where in the world do they get this idea? Well, they teach it in their tradition, but they try to shoehorn Luke 1:28b into meaning this. You can turn your Bibles there, but let me cite it for you. Luke 1:28b, you have Gabriel the angel saying to Mary, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." Now, the Roman Catholic Church and their teachers, who are on the par now with the apostles, claim that when the angel Gabriel says favored one, which comes from the verb karitoo, that is unique. That because she is regarded as favored, she therefore must be sinless. Now, that's quite a leap, and here's why. In Ephesians 1:6, please turn your Bibles there, you're going to see that the same verb karitoo is used for all believers. It's not just unique to Mary. Notice what it says in Ephesians 1:6. It says, "To the praise of the glory of his grace, which he karitoo freely bestowed on us in the beloved." Dear ones, do you see that every single believer is regarded as beloved? Every single believer is a favored one. It's not just Mary. So if we're going to say that favored one means that Mary was sinless, well, then we'd have to apply that to every single believer. We're all sinless. Well, then we have nobody committing sin that needs to be saved. That doesn't make any sense. Dear ones, because the Immaculate Conception doesn't line up with Scripture, it's a $3 bill. It may come from the traditions, but it's not from Scripture. The traditions of these men are at odds with the Scriptures. Let me show you another one. They teach the perpetual virginity of Mary. Now, what's the problem with that? Well, notice I have the remedy on the side. John 7:5 says that Jesus had brothers, adelphoi in the plural. In fact, they didn't initially believe in Jesus until after they saw him raised from the dead. Now, what's the problem with this doctrine of the Roman Catholics if Jesus had brothers? Well, we know Jesus was born of a virgin. But obviously, if he had brothers, siblings, Mary had relations with her husband. Are you with me? Now, the way the Roman Catholic Church will try to get around that is in John 7:5, they will say, well, the term adelphos for brother, you can hear the root for Philadelphia, brotherly love, right? Adelphos, they'll claim, can mean a cousin, and they'll say it's really cousins in John 7:5. The problem with that is there's a Greek term for cousins in the New Testament, anepsios. Anepsios is used of Barnabas' cousin Mark in Colossians 4:10. So, if the Holy Spirit had intended to say that they were cousins, he would have used anepsios through John rather than adelphos. No, adelphos proves Jesus had brothers. They were born in a natural way. She was not a perpetual virgin. You're either going to believe the doctrines and traditions of men, the doctrines of demons, or you're going to believe the Scriptures. Now, it gets more unusual. Many of you probably don't realize that the Catholics claim that Mary offered Jesus to God. But what's the truth of Scripture? Well, the truth of Scripture says in Hebrews 9:24 that Jesus offered himself blameless and spotless to God. You know, the Roman Catholics claim that Mary is the dispenser of the spiritual gifts. What's the Scripture say? Well, 1 Corinthians chapter 12 says that the Holy Spirit dispensed the spiritual gifts. We see in John 16:13 that the Holy Spirit is the one who leads us into truth. In Romans 8:26, we see that the Holy Spirit is the one who intercedes for us in our prayers with groanings too deep for words. It's the Holy Spirit that does this work, and they attribute the work of God to a woman. Now, not only do they attribute the work of the Holy Spirit to Mary, but they attribute the work of Christ to Mary. Notice they claim that she's a co-redemptress or a co-mediator. Now, what's the problem with that? Well, the Scripture says in 1 Timothy 2:15 that there's one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. It's not Mary. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. And so notice they're attributing the work of God to a mere woman. And dear ones, they do this time and time again. They also claim that Mary had a bodily assumption, meaning that she partook of the resurrection before the rest of us. Now, where do they say that? Well, they say that here, again in their catechism. They say, the assumption of the Blessed Virgin is a singular participation in her son's resurrection and an anticipation of the resurrection of other Christians. Dear ones, what's the truth? Well, the truth is revealed in 1 Thessalonians 4:15-17, where Paul breaks all believers into just two groups, those who have died physically and those who haven't died yet. And the point is, when the Lord returns, we're all going to be raised. Now, that means all believers, right? I also want you to think of a passage that's very important. In 1 Corinthians 15:20, who is the first fruits of the resurrection? It's the Lord Jesus Christ. Certainly Mary isn't the first fruits. The first fruits is what guaranteed the rest of the harvest. And it's Jesus alone, not Mary. Dear ones, time and time again, the Roman Catholic Church attribute the work of God to the work of Mary. It's a tradition of men, ultimately a doctrine of demons. Notice what they say again in their catechism of Mary. They say, quote, finally, the Immaculate Virgin, preserved free from all stain of original sin, when the course of her earthly life was finished, was taken up body and soul into heavenly glory. That's the resurrection. And exalted by the Lord as queen over all things, so that she might be the more fully conformed to her Son, the Lord of lords and conqueror of sin and death. Unquote. Dear ones, notice in the red they claim that she's been preserved from all stain and original sin. What does the Scripture say? Well, didn't Solomon say in Ecclesiastes 7:20 that there's not a single righteous man who never sins? Well, as Solomon said that, he means mankind, both male and female. What does Paul say in Romans 3:10? He says there's none righteous, no, not one. Again, the only righteous one was the Lord Jesus Christ, and the tradition of men in the Roman Catholic Church are claiming something for Mary that properly belongs only to the Lord Jesus Christ. Dear ones, the plan of salvation by the Roman Catholic Church comes from a doctrine of demons. We know from Scripture, Ephesians 2:8-10, that we're saved through faith alone in Jesus Christ alone, all by God's grace alone, but they teach it's through works. It's by baptismal regeneration, infused with righteousness, perhaps some cooperation in the merits of the saints, purgatory, and all of these works that they add. Why? Because they're teaching doctrines of demons. And their source comes from their tradition, the very type of tradition that Jesus rebuked with the Pharisees and said, you are abandoning the word of God to hold to your own tradition. Now, as I say this, I know that we have Catholic loved ones, and perhaps there are some here today, perhaps there are some listening. I've got Catholic friends who I adore. My word to you is today is we love you here at Gospel of Grace. I tell you what, years ago before my conversion, I was as lost and as religious and into tradition of men as anyone else. But dear Catholic friends, we want to warn you to depart from the traditions of men and cling to the doctrines of God.